Let me read Matthew chapter 5, verses 6 to 15. Jesus is teaching his disciples to pray. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then in this way: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Amen. God always blesses the public reading of his inspired and his infallible word. I don't know if you, like me, have been moved over the last few weeks by the outpouring of love and support and concern and compassion that men and women have demonstrated to others who have been going through terrible situations. From Manchester, or from Westminster Bridge to Manchester to London Bridge, and then to Grenfell Tower, not only have we seen terrible, awful and indiscriminate acts of violence or sadness or tragedy, but we've also seen the most beautiful expressions of kindness. Men and women that were delivering bucket loads of clothes and food and phone chargers and giving money, doing anything they could to help people that were in real distress. It restores your faith in people, doesn't it? But we also saw something else. In every single situation, we saw prayer walls. If you have been watching the news, then at Grenfell Tower, you see a huge wall with "Pray for us." In Manchester, after the terrible atrocity at the arena that killed so many innocent people, there was a hashtag, "Pray for Manchester." And some of the billboards had "Pray for Manchester" on them in the couple of days afterwards. Who were people praying to? In the United Kingdom, in surveys taken over various times and in various situations, around 90 to 95% of people confess to praying at one point or another in their lives, and yet don't believe in God. So who are they praying to? I often have conversations with people that are not yet Christians. I love that. I wasn't brought up a Christian. I became a Christian when I was 16. I was definitely not a Christian before then. And I thought, actually, all of you that were Christians were bonkers, to be blunt. But I became a Christian when I was 16. And as I got to know God, I discovered something. Often, and I don't know him very well, often people will say to me, "I don't believe in God." And I say back to them, "What God do you not believe in?" Because I may not believe in him either. And normally, what folk mean is, "I don't believe in an angry, vicious, aggressive, vindictive, hateful, spiteful God." Well, that's great news, because neither do I. And nor do Christians. At the beginning of the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, he told them the two most important words that any person could ever understand about faith and about prayer. Martin Luther, the 16th century reformer, whose moment in Wittenberg when he nailed 95 objections to what was happening in the church is commemorated as the 500th anniversary on the 31st of October this year, was once asked, what's the most important thing you've learned in your theology? And he said, I will spend all of my life and all of eternity trying to understand just two words, our Father. When we pray as Christians, when I pray as a follower of Jesus Christ, I know who I'm talking to. I'm not talking into the air. I'm not talking into the ether. I'm not just simply joining with human sentiment and writing something on a wall. So who are you talking to when you pray? In those moments of crisis in your life, or when you with the nation go and light a candle when Princess Diana died, or when somebody else dies, or when something terrible happens, who are you praying to? What is it in us that causes us to yearn to pray? What is it that makes us want to call out to something? I think that it's the image of God in us. It's the fact that all of us in this room, black, white, men, women, gay, straight, whoever you are, wherever you're from, whatever story is your story, you carry the image of God in you. And there's a deep connectedness between that image and God that cannot ever be destroyed. It can be marred, it can be scratched, it can be disfigured, it can be defaced, but it can't be destroyed. And therefore, in their deepest and darkest moments, when people need help, nearly all human beings pray. They call out, hoping for someone or something to help them. Christians believe that that someone is not a force or an entity, it's a person who can be known. And his greatest description is as our Father. Now, some of you may have had a difficulty with that notion, the idea of a father who isn't horrible or vindictive or spiteful, a father who's absent, a father who neglects, a father who abandons. But in Christian faith, God is not a father like that. He's a father who is dedicated, committed, loving, careful, and present with us. I explored some of those things last week as we began to look at this prayer. I just want to think about two words, our Father, again this morning. Our Father who's listening now. Our Father who's interested in us now. Our Father who cares about the decisions that we're making now. Our Father who wants to help us and guide us and direct us and give us courage. Our Father that wants to teach us some lessons about what's right and about what's wrong. And he wants to take our lives and mold them into something even more beautiful for his purposes and for our fulfillments. God isn't an ogre. He's not some kind of mystical figure detached from us. He isn't the clockwork orange or the clockwork orange manufacturer that kicks the world into touch and is not interested in what's happening in your life. He is present. He's interested. He's connected. He's committed to his people and he's committed to his world. One of the things that is important about church, and sometimes people can find church a bit boring. They can find it a bit disconnected from the rest of the world. They can find it a bit uninteresting. So why do we continue to gather together? Why do we pray when we meet together? Well, you know, there is something very powerful about the first two words of the prayer that Jesus taught. Because it's not my Father that he tells me to talk to. It's our Father. He tells me that I find a family here. That I find a place to belong. I find a community that will love me and support me and challenge me when it needs to. But a solid, strong, hopeful family. One of the biggest challenges facing the United Kingdom today in Western Europe is fatherlessness. It's the absence of a dad. And some people end up feeling very angry about that and very bitter. Others just feel very abandoned. It can turn some people into the most wonderful examples of resilient and determined human beings, and others into folk who have been crushed by disappointment that wasn't their fault. Imagine in that context what it means to discover a father who is utterly committed to you. And imagine the power of not only discovering that, but discovering a family that you never knew you had. There are a number of people sitting here today, and I assume joining online, but I know many of you here today, that have been adopted. You know the power of having been chosen, welcomed into a family, given an identity and a place to belong and a place to flourish. When we begin to pray as Christians, our first thought turns to the fact that we are in a family and that we belong and that there's nothing we need to prove. There's nothing we need to do to earn that place. God loves us. And for those of us that have come from broken or dysfunctional families, and I certainly include my own, imagine the power of a church full of mums and dads, aunts and uncles, brothers and sisters, friends, people that will accept us where we are and allow us to be and help us to become what we can be. Prayer roots us in all of that. It roots me in my dependence on you, and it roots you in your dependence on me. And maybe that's the other thing that we've seen in all of the disasters that we have witnessed and the responses to them. Not only an inherent desire to pray, but an inherent desire to help. Because in the end, we recognize a connectedness to one another. We recognize that we need each other. We recognize that we can't do this on our own. And for all of the protestations of modern culture that says we don't need strong community and we don't need places to belong, I have a hunch that more and more people are realizing that we do. Our Father. So what kind of father is he? He's a good father. He's a forgiving father. He's a kind and a merciful father. He's a father who protects and provides for us. Later on in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus, still teaching his disciples about prayer, tells them that their Father will look after them, that he won't abandon them. He uses a wonderful picture. And he says this: some of you are worrying about so many things. You're anxious about what you'll wear. You're anxious about where your money's going to come from. You're anxious about what's going to happen tomorrow. You're worried about what's going to go wrong in your life. You're just mounting up with anxiety. And then he says, look at the lilies in the fields and how beautifully clothed they are and how simple and profoundly beautiful these flowers are. Think about a sparrow with small wings. And he says, will not your Father, who looks after the lilies and the sparrows, also look after you? Will he not also protect you? Will he not also provide for you? He's a Father who protects us and provides for us. But he's also a Father who listens to us and loves us. What is your picture of love? When you hear the word love or our Father's love, what is it that you think of? What image immediately comes into your mind? Is it a kind of Richard Attenborough type figure that lifts you up and hugs you and plonks you on his knee? Or is it some kind of sporty Bear Grylls type dad that drags you everywhere with him and makes you into this super fit human being? What image of father springs to your mind? A good father, a loving father. The image that the Bible presents of God as a father is someone who will defend you. It's Someone who will wrap his arms around you and shield you from storms. Someone who will love you not when you get better, not when you change, not when you pass a test, not when you've proven that you deserve his love, but he loves you now. With all of your foibles and mistakes, with all of our weaknesses and insecurities, with all of our anxieties and our questions and our fears, he loves us. And it's his love flowing in us that changes us, rather than us changing in order to gain his love. He loves us enough to listen to us, to be interested in the decisions that we make, and to want to participate in those decisions through prayer, inviting us into a dialogue with him, a conversation where he listens and he guides us through his scripture and he guides us through the example of his son, Jesus Christ. And thirdly, and lastly, he's a father who tells us the truth, who disciplines us, who loves us enough to say, what you're doing isn't good for you, son. The way you're living is not, in the end, going to bring you happiness. How many of you have heard of the Ten Commandments? They're words from the Old Testament. Actually, the way they're written in the Old Testament, they're sometimes referred to as the Decalogue. And Decalogue actually means 10 words. They contain a whole range of things, like you shall have no other god before me. And you shall not worship any other god but me. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not lie. You shall not steal. You shall not be jealous. Honor your father and mother so that your days may be long upon the earth. There are 10 of them. Many people struggle with them, Christians and non-Christians, because they feel like what they've been given is a list of regulations that they have to abide by, and if they don't, they're out. That depends on the tone of how you hear them when you read them. So for those of you that have an idea of a father who is a particularly gruesome figure, when you hear words like commandment, what you imagine in your head is somebody with a stick and a pointing finger saying, don't do that, 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 don't do that. A good Irish preacher probably is what you think of. But what if the tone of these words isn't that at all? What if the tone of the words is more like this? Don't do that. Because that's not good for you. That's going to hurt you. That's going to drag you away from what it means to be truly human. If you spend your life running from one relationship to another and never coming to terms with who you are, you're going to end up miserable, having a cheapened understanding of yourself and a disconnected understanding of your place in the world. Don't do that. And don't lie. Because when you lie, you break a trust between two people and you create a facade that's impossible to keep up, and you find yourself having to tell another lie, then another lie, then another lie, and then before you realize it, your life has become a lie. And all your energy and your passion is being poured into keeping up this facade of being successful and healthy and happy and saying the things that you think everybody else needs to hear. Don't do that. And don't worship another god. Because if you worship another god, you're worshiping something that will ultimately control you. If you worship money, you'll think you're free. But the more money you get, the more money you'll need. If you worship position, you'll think that you've made it, but when you get to the top of the tree, you suddenly become fearful that somebody behind you is going to take your slot. If you worship education, then when you thought you've learned everything and there's nothing else to learn, you suddenly realize that there's so much more to learn, you're never going to learn it. And you might not be able to retain it because that mind that you've prided yourself on may begin to fail a little. Don't worship power. Don't worship money. Don't worship position. Because they all entangle you in the end. Worship me. Because when you worship me, I really set you free. Because I know what it is to be human. I designed you. I know what's best for you. And if you live in what I have made you to be, you become free. Our Father speaks strongly to us, not to curtail us, not to control us, not to squash us, but to liberate us, to give us life, and to give us hope, and to give us purpose, and to give us meaning. And when we hear those types of words, we begin to be changed. I find prayer difficult, because God sometimes says no to me. Not on small things, on big things. He said no to me about people that I didn't want to die. He said no to me about circumstances that I wanted to see changed. He has said no to me about healing for people that I really love. God sometimes says no, because good parents know how to care for and love their children, even when we don't appreciate it. What would it look like to you if you met a God who was interested in every decision that you're going to make, who loved you, who cared for you, and wanted to help you? What would it look like for you to know that there was a God who wasn't an ethereal force or power, but that he loved you so much that he would give the best of himself for you so that you could become the best version of you? What would it look like for you if there was someone who was willing to take all the mess that you have made of your life and to change it by the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ? Years ago, a friend told a story of going to France. Some of you here at Gold Hill will know this story. And walking along the banks of the river in Paris, I can never pronounce it, is it Seine or Seine? Seine. Well, an Irishman, I could say both and you wouldn't know any difference anyway. The Seine. And as he was walking along, he saw pictures. But they weren't very good. He was with his wife. And his wife and him were looking at these pictures being displayed by an artist. And he said, oh, I don't really like that picture. There's no shape to it. I don't like it at all. And his wife said, shh. And he said, no, well, I just don't like it. And he heard somebody coughing behind him. Who do you think it was? It was the artist. And the artist said to him, shall I do my best French accent? I'm going to sound like somebody from Allo Allo now. The artist said to him, Monsieur, you do not like my painting. And he said, no, it's not too bad. And he looked at it again and said, actually, no, I'm not overly keen. And she said, look at the price tag on the corner. And he looked at it and he said, it's not, definitely not that nice. And then she showed him a bigger one. And it was even more expensive. And he said, that's really expensive. And then she showed him a third one, which was the biggest of all, and it was the most expensive. And he said, that is far more than I think it's worth. And she smiled. She looked at him. And she said, sir, a painting is not worth what you think it's worth. My paintings are worth what somebody is willing to pay for them. So how much do you think you're worth? See, most of my life I felt I was pretty worthless. If you put me in a room of 100 people, I'd put myself at the bottom of it. But I'm not worth what I think I'm worth. I'm worth what somebody's willing to pay for me. So what did God think I was worth? God thought I was worth the death of his Son. He thought I was worth everything. And he thought I was so worth that he was willing to do anything to get to me. Because he's my Father those of you that are good mums or good dads, how much are your kids worth to you? What would you give to rescue them? What extent would you go to find them if they got lost? How long would you search for? How hard would you look? You'd go to the ends of the earth, wouldn't you? You would do anything and everything to get to your youngster if they needed you. In prayer, we connect ourselves with a God who will do everything and anything to get to us. And he looks at us and he says, I know you think you're worthless, but to me, you're worth everything. So let's pray. Let's talk to this Father who thinks we are worth so much. Sometimes we have turned prayer, Lord, into a shopping list or a set of words that we've learned. And there's no doubt that there are times when we have to ask you for specific things. But thank you, as we come to you today, we come to a Father who loves us, who knows us and who is interested in us. Whatever our journey has been, whatever our story to this point, would you come nigh and meet with us? Some people watching online or in this room may never have spoken to you before. Would you introduce yourself to them? Some of us have not spoken to you for a very long time. Not a proper communication, not a real conversation. Today, come and whisper your love into every heart. Speak your comfort and your hope into every single person. Some of us feel as if we've made a lot of mistakes. Those commandments that we've heard, the things that we know in our lives that are not adding up, have made us feel pretty worthless. Would you deal with those in us? Would you show us that you have forgiven us? And would you turn our eyes toward you as a good Father? Would you speak hope into our hearts? Would you give us courage? Would you forgive us? And help us to start again with you at the center of our lives. These things we pray. For Jesus' sake.